Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men to dwell. Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glories by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, we come into your presence, Father, with glory, with joy, with praise to you, Lord, and we thank you tonight for this gathering of your people to declare the worthiness, God, of who you are and what you have done, that you weren't a God who just said that you loved us, but you demonstrated that love and that while we were all sinners, Christ died for us. We thank you, Lord, that we gather with confidence in our heart, that we can come to you, that we can access you with boldness. And we do that, Lord, through the finished work of Jesus. So to each person here tonight, Lord, I pray that you would bless, that you would strengthen, that you would give courage, that you would enlighten, that you would give us, Lord, the light that we need to know the truth of who Christ is, and that we would go away with practical lessons in our life. Thank you for the Christmas story. Thank you for the individual people in the story and the lessons that are embedded there. Just unleash those lessons in our life tonight and help us, Lord, to be different people, to be holy people, to be fun, to be joy-filled, and to take that with us wherever we go. It's all about you tonight. We love you and praise you. In Christ's name, God's people said, amen. All right, thank you. You can be seated, and we're just going to enjoy a lot of good music. And so Jeff's going to get us started here with O Holy Night.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul a thrill of hope. The weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees. Oh, hear the angel voice. His law is love. break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His power and glory evermore proclaim. His power and glory evermore proclaim.
Amen. Great job, Jeff. God is blessing our church in so many different ways, and one of the ways is growth in our Bible study experience and our spiritual growth. And one of the classes that we started, probably Mike and Lisa, what, a couple of years ago, maybe? And we thought, we really need a truly young adult Sunday school class, because all the rest of us are getting older, okay? And so So I approached Mike and Lisa, and they've been so gracious and so strong to give leadership to this class. So I have asked them to come tonight and to introduce many of their members that are here tonight, to introduce them to you, and to just give them an opportunity to give testimony and to give tribute of what God is doing in the life of this church, but also in their Bible study group, and what God is doing to just grow them in Christ. So Mike, why don't you come? Lisa, you come, and we're excited about getting to know this class a little bit better tonight. Thank you.
Lisa and I are very young, so it helps us, right?
Yeah.
So I've asked several to come and introduce themselves, and y'all can stand down here if you want to, and then I'll ask the four of you to come up. First of all, just a plug for us. We meet at 10 o'clock. It goes everywhere from just out of high school until we won't put a cap age on it. But anyone who wants to come, we meet every week. We will not call on you. We will not ask you to read. We will not ask you to pray in public, okay? So if anybody has people in this age group that would like to come, we'd love to have you. I've asked several of them tonight to introduce themselves and kind of tell you, well, I'm going to ask them this. Most of these people, well, it's all couples tonight. It normally isn't all couples. However, I'd like to ask you, like, when you met your significant other. I'm sorry, I threw that on you. Promised I wouldn't do that, but oh well. Logan, you're up. Does this mic work?
I don't think so.
If not, at least we can pull this.
Yeah, come on up here.
Come on, Logan.
Come on, Logan. Yeah. There you go. And then there's one over here.
Okay. Yeah. I'm Logan one? Neville, formerly Logan Chenier, grew up here. But my husband is Will Neville, and we met technically in pre-K.
There you go. All right.
And we finally got together our senior year of high school after a lot of back and forth. But yeah, we dated for, I guess, 5 or 6 years and got married in 2021. So we're coming up on 2 years tomorrow.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. That's great.
I guess I'll go.
There you go.
My name is Dustin Tim. I'm from Iola. I met my wife Peyton in junior high. We started dating when I was 16. We got married on our 8-year anniversary. And yeah,
watch
I got
out.
And we have one son, Sutton, and we have another one on the way. So Briggs will be here in April, so we will have two little ones
there
come
April.
There you
go. Yep. That's good. That's good.
I had to confer with Catherine to make sure I knew when we met. It was sometime when I was in third grade and she was in fourth. The first memory I have is going to preteen camp, I think probably Lake Highlands. I remember the trip going there. I thought she was pretty cute. And then we, you know, we kind of like Will and Logan, kind of took a while. And then after high school, we started dating, and we dated for a little over 6 years and got married back in 2020. And it's been great ever since. And then we got a couple of fun ones.
My name's Tanner Wehot. I'm married to Heather Wehot, formerly Heather Harvey. We met when we were quite young, third grade or so at Aggieland Goat Camp. She has no recollection of that, but I do. We got together in college and dated for a little bit in college, and then we parted ways and went separate directions for a while, and then we reconnected 3 years ago, something like that. Got married last year in November.
Great.
Heather finally saw the error in her ways and came.
She did.
All right, so I'm going to let spouses go back and sit down so Sutton and John can entertain us and ask the four of you to step up.
There we go.
Good. So, yeah, I think it's really kind of cool that a lot of these people have known each other for years. They dated in high school. They have lived their life around each other. They're still friends. And to me, that's remarkable. I mean, to know someone that long and still be that closely tied to them. So I've given them a list of questions, and my mother would be horrified. I'm looking at my phone in church, but I wrote it down on my phone, and that's how we communicate. So here we go. So the first question is, when you're in high school, right, I'm sure you had dreams about what Christmas as a married couple would look like, right? So I want to know the difference in the dream and the reality.
I guess I'll go first.
All right, go ahead.
I think when I was a kid, I mean, Christmas was all about just the presents and just being out of school for a couple weeks. You know, it was just a fun time to visit all your family who's from out of town and all that good stuff. And then you get married and you're like, oh, well, I got to be with this one. We got to go everywhere. But no, and then I don't know how to explain it. We only had one Christmas as a married couple without a child. And so now that we have a Christmas where we get to share with our son, it totally changed the meaning of Christmas for me. You start actually thinking about what Christmas is actually about. You know, it's not about the presents and all the food and all the fun stuff anymore. It's thinking of the real meaning of Christmas and trying to set an example for our kids, even though they are so young. You know, just trying to make sure you are doing the right things from the get-go. So I think that's how different it is for me. But
great.
We just go in line.
Just random, yeah. Okay. We're good in lines.
For me, I suppose in high school.
Yeah.
By the time I would be 32 today, mm-hmm. I expected to be married for several years and have a couple kids on the ground and having a cush job and, you know, kind of being my own boss mm-hmm. kind of deal. And it is not at all like that. not in the slightest. That cush job is not quite come to fruition yet. We'll keep working on it. But I wouldn't change anything today for what we have. We have our own home, but we don't get to live there yet. We're kind of working through that. We're living with our wonderful in-laws, or my wonderful in-laws, Heather's wonderful parents. And honestly, we wouldn't change not a thing. But coming to realize that it's all part of the plan and it's part of God's plan, and it's not up to me and it's not up to us to decide when things are supposed to happen. And we're still learning that daily and going through that, but dramatically different.
Yes, dramatically.
Yeah, I don't remember ever thinking about Christmas as a married person when I was younger, but I know that my, you know, my ideas and my thoughts of what marriage was going to look like has been drastically different, and definitely for the better. You know, I had something in mind, and I thought it was going to be a certain way, and then it's so much more than that. There's so much more to being married than just living with somebody you like. You know, it goes deeper than that, and I, you know, every day it's us understanding and loving each other more and more, and, you know, to have kids together has been wild ride, a lot of big learning experience, especially for me, just figuring out that I'm pretty useless for a newborn, you know, not a whole lot I can do, but, you know, you know, just trying to do my best. But it's great to get to see all the excitement that John has, and hearing him say Santa and ho, 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 and the outfits aren't fun. You know, I didn't get the memo about the plaid, but all in all, it's been a neat experience.
Growing up, I've been blessed to have all of our family pretty local. We don't have to travel to be able to spend the holidays together, and that's still true with Will's family into the picture now. We're all local, so that's a huge blessing of getting to just travel at least 30 minutes, maybe an hour at the most, to spend the holidays as a family. So I always dreamt that would still be the same, which it is. As a couple, I guess high school couple, we had always talked about, I guess, trips being our holiday experience, you know, ski trips or whatever that may look like. So that looks different now, just not being as our life has worked out, but maybe down the road. But just still being very appreciative that we can spend it as a family with both sides of our family now that we're together and making that tradition carry on.
Thank you. Okay, so the other thing that we've talked about probably over the last 4 to 5 months, you know, some of us are more hard-headed than others, and I just feel like God has been really pushing this on us. So we come to church, and Brother Tim preaches a sermon, and then we go to our Sunday school lesson, and it's the same thing. And kind of historically, it's been waiting on God and waiting on his perfect plan. And we've just, it's like we have drilled that into ourselves, and every week is something new. And it's really been exciting to see how that all works out. So I guess my next question is, so obviously we've been talking about that until we're blue in the face, right? So each of our lives are busy every day, and they all change. So what I'd like you to share is just something you're waiting on right now from God, that you are just waiting on that perfect answer and his perfect plan, and how the church can pray for you specifically about those things. Logan, we'll start with you this time.
So like we said, we've been talking a lot about waiting on, what are we waiting on? So a month after our marriage, Will had a medical incident where he was in the hospital for 6 months, and a lot went into that, but we were in the hospital from January to June and came home with a completely new outlook on life and just new challenges to go through together. So I guess through all of that, it obviously has turned our worlds upside down on what we thought our marriage would be, what our goals were, what we thought our freshly newlywed life would be like. So when he asked, what are you waiting on? I honestly don't know what we're waiting on. I don't know how to put into words what our future will be like. And so I think I'm finally came to the thought this morning after our Sunday school lesson that just waiting on peace in the unknown, knowing that I can't control my future, I can't control our future, I can't fix it, I can't change it, but just waiting on peace, that knowing that it's in God's hands, and his plan is always gonna be greater than what I deem as what I want my life to look like.
Right.
So just praying for peace, and that the unknown is always gonna be greater than what I think my known should be. So.
Right.
Yeah, that was really good this morning. We had that conversation, and Logan said that. I was like, remember exactly that and say it tonight. But isn't that so true that we don't know what tomorrow holds, and that the peace that passes all understanding is what
right.
we need.
Right.
And I think for myself too, just you know, I've gone through a lot lately between my house and then my dad, you know, passing away this past summer. It was unexpected, right? Both events, and makes it hard, right? It was a hard season, and then we were also expecting our second child, and you know, just a lot going on there. But just having a faith to fall back on, having Christ to fall back on, and to to know that at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Whatever happens, you know, Christ is still Lord, you know, has been huge, and very thankful for that. And, you know, with our busy lives, with raising the kids and work and everything else, you know, it's hard. We like to say, oh, we need to set aside time for God. But I think it's important to remember that, it's important to remember that, you know, it's not our time to begin with, right? So we're supposed to be, he's supposed to be our number one priority through all that. But definitely just finding the balance of work and raising the kids and loving Catherine and, of course, above all, you know, loving Christ.
Let me think. So when we started talking about, like, what are we waiting on, I started to think about all this stuff. Like, what am I waiting on? I don't know. Like, I just sort of how they said, like, I don't know. I'm 26 years old. I've got a almost two-year-old kid. I've got one on the way. I don't know what's coming next. You know, I don't know.
You're
In the short time that I've been out of college, I've worked at a bank, worked for myself, and now I have a new job. And it's like, I don't know what's next. And it sort of caught me today in Sunday school. We were talking, we've been focusing on for 2 months about what are we waiting on God to do for us? And it's occurred to me, like, maybe God is waiting on me, you know, starting to bring my family to church more, just starting to, and we'll touch on this later, but starting a Bible study every week with my friends, like, maybe God was waiting on me to come to him. You know, maybe I don't need to just sit around on my hands and wait for something to happen. You know, if you have a problem, you need to seek it out. And so that's what I got out of the whole waiting discussion was that.
Yeah, that was an aha this moment. This morning.
Yeah, this morning. I've been thinking quite a bit about it, and I still don't know what I want to say right now. So I'm really winging it.
And if you want to, step back.
As far as what we're waiting on, there's things and aspirations and goals that we have in our mindset between Heather and I and our family and what we would really like to come to fruition. And we've been struggling and coming around to terms that it's all part of God's plan and it's part of God's time. Yeah. And when we begin talking about what are we waiting on, and it's, well, I mean, I don't know necessarily waiting on it. We're coming to terms with it's not in our hands. It's not in our control, and we have to trust and go out and do what we were commissioned to do. And for us, it's not necessarily what are we waiting on. And I think we're coming around to the concept of with Sunday school and with the lessons that we've been learning here in church, that we've come to terms that it's not in our control, and it's in God's time.
That's good.
Good.
Amen.
Okay, and last but not least, so this group, specifically these two, started a Bible study, and I want them to talk a little bit about why they started it, what that Bible study is about, and what it means to you kind of as a friend group.
Yeah. You can go there over here.
Yeah.
I guess I can start. So I was raised in church. Like, my family took me to church every time the doors opened, like Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Every time the doors were open, we were there. And then we get older, and we move away from where I was born, and you leave your home church, and then you just go to school, and then you move to college, and then you slowly stop going to church. It just doesn't. It just slips away from you somehow. And I move back home, and I start a family, and I have kids, and I start thinking of, you know, what life do I want to give my children? You know, I want to give my kids the opportunity that my parents gave me, and that's just bring me to church. Just give me the opportunity to know God. And so I just started reflecting on myself, and I mean, me and Will, we've been best friends since we were little kids, and he's always been that person you can go to if you have any questions about Jesus or church or God or anything like that. He's always been that person for me. And so one day I just texted him out of the blue. I was looking back at the text message today. It's this big, long message. I won't read it because I'll probably cry, but it pretty much just said, like, man, I need help. I don't know what it is I need from this. I told him, I was like, we can start it if it's just you and I. Like, I just have a bunch of questions, and I didn't know where to go. And so, I mean, thank the Lord for Will. He just texted back. He was like, for sure, man, and we'll invite all of our friends. And so we have a huge friend group. If you don't know, like, our friends and our friend group, there's like 16 of us anytime we get together. So he was like, let's just invite everybody. And so we did, and we started every Wednesday night about 12 weeks ago. I don't think we missed a week yet, and it was, I think we had like 8 people the first time, and then it just gradually got bigger, and we just rotate between houses. And I don't, they're probably not the best sermons ever. I wouldn't call them sermons, but we just started in the book of John. We read a chapter a night, and then it's, the best part about it is just sitting there with your friends and getting to talk and ask like any random question that you might be nervous to ask, like in front of people that you haven't known your whole life. And so, yeah, that's the best part for me. I'm glad that we did it.
And I think you might have asked me on like a Sunday or a Monday about it. And I think we had the first one just that next Wednesday. I was like, okay, well, let's figure it out. We'll have it at your house. It was Monday because I remember
being at work, and I was like, just something didn't feel right. So I texted you.
And you know, it's been, I've never felt like that I could talk to people about, you know, talked to a bunch of all my friends about the Bible and things like that, and had no idea where to start, or I was looking at different books or lessons or something we could go through. And then finally I was like, I can't find anything. I didn't have enough time. So we just started in John. I think we spent like 4 weeks on John chapter one, but you know, it was just going through, and it's fun. 'Cause you know, there's a lot of different people with a lot of different backgrounds and different levels of just knowledge of the Bible and of the gospel. And so it's pretty fun, the different questions we get. And sometimes we go off on tangents and it has nothing to do with whatever we're studying, and we'll just kind of go over and trying to pick through stuff. And you know, I'm thankfully Catherine's there too to sometimes reel me in when I'm going off on a tangent, or if we're you know, if I don't know or don't have a good understanding of what the question was. But it's been great, and it's fun. It's never something I thought that would happen, but we've got some, you know, a good group going, and it's been fun every week.
I think the last thing I'll say about it is Mr. Mike talked about it this morning at Sunday school. He said his favorite part about it is we do have so many friends, and we have friends who come to our Bible study every week, but they might not go to church. You know, like that might be the only time that they read the Bible or talk about God. And that's just so cool to me, because I've known all these people my entire life. Like, we've grown up together. And if Will and I, and I mean, Logan is a huge part of the group too, but like if we can just do one little thing and maybe just have one of our friends get to talk about God once a week, like that makes it all worth it to me. So
absolutely. But yeah, it's
good. Logan, is there anything you need to add to clean up their mess? Okay. Good deal. Well, I think you see kind of from this that God is working, and God is moving in everyone's life. And you never know the struggles that one person is going through, right, and how important that is to be supportive in that.
That's right.
Thank you.
Amen. It's good. Good job, guys. Mr. Kenneth, you come. We've just heard how we need the constant guidance of the Lord. So Kenneth's going to come and share a song with us.
I assume that anybody that gets up here gives you all of their history. Are y'all ready for this? We were married in 1965. That's before some of these people were around, I think. But if you just let God have his way, he'll work it out. When y'all figure it out, let me know, because I haven't got it yet. I'm going to try to sing. Okay. Not that. Thank you.
Tears are falling, hearts are breaking. How we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, Holy Child. Welcome, Holy Child. Hope that you don't mind our manger. How I wish we would have known. But long awaited, holy stranger, make yourself at home. Please make yourself at home. Bring your peace into our violence. Bid our hungry souls be filled. We're now breaking heaven's silence. Welcome to our world. Welcome to our world.
If you have your Bible here this evening, I'd like you to turn to Matthew chapter 1. And this morning we started looking at Jesus' family. Actually, this past Wednesday night, we started looking at Jesus' family in this genealogy that Matthew records for us in the first 17 verses. And I know that you've probably heard what I've heard tonight, and that's the presence of some children in our midst. Amen. And that has always been, just to set parents at ease, that's always been music to my ears. Because I remember there being a time in this church where we had very little, if any, children. And so to hear children is just saying, you know, we're being the church that God wants us to be. So we're looking at family, the family that Jesus came into. And we're also looking at the fact that when we come to Christ and submit ourselves to Him, that He makes us family. So today we looked at His mother, Mary. And so tonight I want us to look a little bit more in depth at His father, His earthly father, Joseph. And so we hear Him, we see Him described in Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 19. And it says, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law. Now, I want to stop right there. Some of your translations have the fact that he was a good man, that because he was a just man, that he was a holy man, a spirit-filled man, a loving man, a faithful man. He was the kind of man that you would want your sons to be, and he's the kind of man that you would want your daughter to marry. We don't know a whole lot about him. But if this right here in the scripture, if this is all that we knew, it really tells us everything that we need to know about him. And so it says, because he was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose Mary to public disgrace, that he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. So the situation is simply this, that Joseph has worked very hard to prepare himself for marriage, because marriage, according to the Bible, is not for men. I mean, is not for boys, it's for men. This means that he has taken a job, means that he has moved out of his mother and father's home. It means that he has taken responsibility for himself. He's worshiping God, but he's also paying his bills. He's living his life. And even though he's young, he is a grown man. There is a myth in our culture. And the myth goes, we'll say things like this: when I get older and wiser. And when I hear that, I think, well, maybe. You can get older and more foolish. Or you can be young and humble and dependent upon God, and you can be wise. Joseph is a man who has wisdom. He's not excusing adolescence. He's not excusing immaturity, as many young men do. He's not freeloading off of his parents. He's not looking for a good time. He's trying to make a good legacy of himself. He's looking for a wife, not just a date. He's looking for a family, not just a pleasure. And so this young man has taken upon himself a great, huge responsibility. He is now ready to be married. And this means that Mary's family has approved. They've looked at him and they've gotten to know his character. They've gotten to know his work ethic. And they have said, we approve. This also means that the congregation of God's people, of which they were a part, has approved. This means that Joseph has presented himself as a worthy man. And that in itself is a lot of responsibility. Let's say, like we said this morning about Mary, let's say that he's 16. Let's say that he's 18, maybe 20 years of age. Does that not make this all the more amazing? And he's chosen Mary. He's probably known her since they were kids. He may have loved her since he was a little boy. And you see her in the synagogue. He has done that. He has seen her in town. That's Mary. His heart was inclined toward her. And perhaps one of the greatest motivations that he had to mature and to grow up and to start taking some responsibility was so that he could get as many years with Mary as his wife as he possibly could, which meant that he had some incentive to start taking responsibility and to carry himself as a man at a very young age. And he has done it. He's done it. He has made that bold, courageous move of asking for her hand in marriage and receiving her blessing and receiving her parents' blessing. And so now they are, this morning, legally covenanted together as husband and wife, and there is a date set for their wedding. And everybody knows that their wedding is coming because it is a small town. Mary's making all the preparations. And sometimes their wedding celebrations could last upwards to a week. And it was feasting and it was celebrating. And it was more of probably an Eastern tradition. And you ladies that have gotten married, you know what that looks like to get ready for it. You ladies that are preparing to get married, you know what that looks like. So this was a very hopeful, joy-filled, hopeful season of your life. And then Joseph gets, I think, the most devastating news possible. She's pregnant. Mary? I see her sing to the Lord every Sabbath in the synagogue. She's memorized huge portions of Scripture. I thought she was the godliest girl that I had ever met. And here it is. I've been praying. I've been waiting. I've been striving for years. She's pregnant. I'm still a virgin. I haven't laid my hands on that woman. We have not yet consummated our covenant. She's pregnant. And this was 2,000 years ago in a very conservative, you think Iola's conservative, in a very conservative rural town where everybody probably was Jewish. And that makes this particularly scandalous and devastating. So the question is, what is Joseph going to do? Well, the scripture tells us here that he had decided to divorce her quietly. Because they had covenanted together to cancel the betrothal season and to nullify the forthcoming wedding, it actually required legal action. It required a divorce. And so Joseph is looking at being divorced before he's married. And so what Joseph decides to do, because he's a godly man, he's a humble man, he's an honorable man, he doesn't want to be with her, but he doesn't want to destroy her. He doesn't want to be with her, but he doesn't want to shame her. He doesn't want to be with her, but he doesn't want to punish her. And men, do you see that? He's not getting vengeance. He's not ruining her reputation. But then something happens. God breaks in. Joseph goes to bed one night, probably staining his pillow with tears. He's a devastated man. The Bible says that an angel showed up, spoke to him during his dream, and told him what was about to happen with the conception and the birth of Jesus, that conception, that birth was from the Holy Spirit. And what Joseph receives, I want to make this very, very clear, it is miraculous, okay? It is a revelation from God. An angel comes. Angels are divine beings. They are created by God. They don't inhabit human bodies or physical bodies. They are spirit beings, and they exist for two functions. One function is they're messengers, and the second function is they are ministers. So they go and they speak on God's behalf, and then they serve and they minister on God's behalf. And so an angel comes to explain to Joseph that it's the Holy Spirit, that God Himself has done a miraculous, a supernatural thing, that the laws of nature are in pencil and not pen, that God can show up and that God can do things that otherwise could not be done. And listen, church, that is what we believe. And that is why we believe in Christ, is that we believe in a God who can give sight to the blind. We believe in a God that can give hearing to the deaf. We believe that God can, when He chooses, He can even raise the dead. And we believe that God will do this for all of His people at the end of time forever. He'll raise us up with glorified bodies. Amen? So we believe in the miraculous. We believe in the supernatural. And I know that there might be some here tonight who would say, well, this seems, Brother Tim, this seems rather uncommon. This seems rather unusual. Well, by definition, that's what a miracle is. A miracle is a miracle because it doesn't happen all the time. It's unusual. And it's unusual for an angel to show up and for an angel to start communicating. But here is the miracle that has occurred, that Mary is going to give birth to a son, but she has not sinned. And so here is the question for all of us. This morning I sort of picked on the ladies a little bit. So tonight I'm going to pick on the men. And so I'm going to put this question out there, particularly to our men. Men, Here's the question. Will you love and lead the family that God has given to you, that God has planned for you to have, even if, listen to this, even if it's not the one that you envisioned? Will you still love the Lord and love the family that God gives to you? This was not the family that Joseph envisioned. His vision of his future is, I'm a virgin, she's a virgin. And that means that she's not pregnant. That means that we don't have to alter the dress. That means that nobody is whispering during our ceremony. That means that there are no questions about our integrity. We get married. We live a simple life. Maybe an obscure life. In the middle of nowhere, and people don't talk about us. Let me say this. And particularly for our men, most of the time, the script that you have written for your future and the script that you have written for your family is probably different from the script that God's going to hand you. And you have a decision to make. Will I read the script that God has handed me? Will I accept that script? Will I follow that script? Or will I abandon this woman and go find another and hand her my script? I would say to every single one of us, be very, very careful the vision that you have for your life. And you better, if you've got a vision, you better hold that out pretty loosely. Make sure that you're loving God. Make sure that you're glorifying God. Make sure that you're honoring God. Make sure that you're following the Lord Jesus Christ. And if He should hand you a script that is different than the one that you have written, then I would say, by all means, as we've heard tonight, go with His plan. Go with His plan. This was not Joseph's plan. Because had Joseph been meeting with his life coach and putting together his 7-year plan, y'all know how that goes. You know, where do you see yourself in 7 years, Joseph? Well, what would Joseph have said? I see myself with Mary. She's got a really great reputation. And no one really knows who we are. And what I want to do is I just want to be with her and I want to live a quiet, simple, country life. Well, Joseph, how about this one? How about you marry a single mother? How about even though she's godly and sinless insofar as her sexual activity is concerned, everybody is going to think, you know what everybody's going to think? Everybody's going to think that she's a tramp. And your wife is going to have a really bad reputation, which is admittedly hard in a small town, right? And your son, well, maybe they're going to say horrible things about him too. And you're going to be the laughingstock of this whole town because everybody's going to think it's a joke. It's a joke that your wife cheated on you and then told you it was the Lord. And you are gullible enough to believe it and to raise somebody else's kid. Now, I don't know whether you think I'm pressing that a little hard, but that's exactly what happened. The gospel tells a story that some come to Jesus when Jesus is older and they throw out this phrase to him. At least we know who our father is. What are they saying? Your mom has slept with so many men, you don't know who your daddy is. And you know what Jesus tells them? Jesus has this great line in response to that. He says, your father is the devil. That's a pretty good line, isn't it? But men, listen to me. Would you agree that this is not the plan that Joseph had envisioned for his life, or his wife, for his family, for his son, but he accepted, as Mary accepted this morning, he accepted God's plan for their life. For you single men here tonight, don't take the path of least resistance. Don't do that. That's what these young adults are telling you. Don't do that. Take the path that has the most glory to God. And don't write a script in pen. At best, make sure that you write it in pencil, right? To all of our parents tonight, to all of our grandparents tonight, will you love and lead the family that God has given to you? Even if it's not the one that you envisioned. Well, Brother Tim, had I known that she'd be like this, I wouldn't have signed up for this thing for a lifetime. I've heard that many a time. Had I known that the kids would be like this, I wouldn't have signed up for a lifetime. Had I known that they would get sick or that I would get sick, had I known what their extended family would be like, had I known that their sins, the sins in their past that have haunted us in the present, had I known that they would betray me in this way or fail me in this way, I never would have signed up for a lifetime of this. And Joseph says, that's fine. That's fine. It's going to be hard. But the Lord has spoken. The Lord has revealed himself. And I put my trust in him. And his vision for my family is my vision for my family. And let me say this, and let me say this to you men particularly. I feel really inclined tonight to do this. I think it's from God that if God should give some of you men a difficult family, listen to me, it is not a burden, it is an honor, because God has entrusted to you a great responsibility for the woman and for the children that he loves very dearly. And perhaps God didn't give it to another man because he wasn't sure that his daughter would be loved well and that his children would be raised well. Had Joseph taken this as a burden, he would have been embittered against the Lord. Why such a difficulty? Why such a difficult path? Why such a difficult plan for me? But that's not Joseph. Instead, he took it as a divine assignment from the Lord and a great honor from God. I think this is what he thought. Someone needs to love Mary. Somebody needs to love her. And somebody needs to raise the Son of God. Sign me up. Sign me up. In closing, sometimes God sends the best people on the toughest missions. And just because God has given you a difficult situation, that doesn't mean that he has in any way burdened you. He's blessed you. He's blessed you with a tremendous opportunity. I don't know about you, I appreciate the Christmas story, and I appreciate that Joseph received it in that way. He doesn't say a lot, but I'm going to tell you, church, he does a lot. He does a lot. And that is Jesus' earthly father, Joseph. Count it all joy when you face trials of many kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith is developing perseverance. And perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Amen? We're going to enjoy Grace singing Silent Night, Holy Night. And as she sings this, we're going to light our candles. And when you see me stand, we're going to stand. But let's start being seated, and let's enjoy the music, and then we'll start lighting the candles through the sanctuary here. Thank you. Father, we thank you tonight for a beautiful time of worship to you. We thank you, Father, for those timeless truths that, Lord, are embedded in this Christmas story that will live through the ages. Long before we were here, Lord, this truth was changing lives. And long after we are gone, if Jesus tarries, it'll still be changing life. Lord, in the silence of this evening, in the stillness of it, but also in the truth of it, as you have reminded us of just what is actually the eternal value of life itself, we pray that every single heart will anchor ourselves to a relationship with Jesus Christ, and in Him that we will find the light and the life that you've created us for. Lord, we love you. We thank you for such a special evening as this, and we give it all back to you and entrust it to you. In Christ's name we pray. God's people said, amen. Let's sing together, O Come, All Ye Faithful. Great, great song, great evening. And I want to thank everyone, particularly the Sunday school class. Mike, y'all did great. Every one of you did amazing. And the music was also just off the charts. So we want you to stay afterwards for our fellowship. We've got plenty of food, and we put it all together. And there's a lot of good Christmas goodies. I know there's some chocolate back there, okay? God is good. So let's sing together, O Come, All Ye Faithful, okay? Here we go. O come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold Him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing all ye bright host of heaven above. Glory to God all, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Amen. Senior adults, I want you to go first back to the goodies, okay? So y'all leave, okay? Yes, be careful with the candles, all right? We love you guys. Thank y'all so much.